Damn, she got my mail already. Whoa. Wow. I mailed that last week. I mailed her a bag of candy corn. Because apparently you can't get that in France.
Really?
I was like, well, I can mail you some wax and corn syrup. In corn shape. The true American fruit.
Not even in corn shape. It's like a little cone.
Not kernels. Yeah, I'm not as big a fan of those pumpkin ones.
Yeah, because the pumpkin ones are too much of that ingredients. They're too
thick.
Yeah,
they're too fat.
The proportions thrown off.
It's too orange. You need the illusion of other flavors.
I've never tasted like a different flavor. I mean, I've had those chocolate ones,
I mean,
but they all
there
kind of
isn't
taste the same.
A flavor. Yeah, they all taste the same. I just mean like you need those colors to like give you a sense that like, these are going to be different flavors. Different parts of this corn. They're going to be a different flavor. But yeah, the chocolate ones are no different. Although apparently they're like caramel apple ones. And I was kind of like, huh. That would be interesting.
I'm sure they suck too. But yeah.
Yeah, I still want to eat them. I bought a pack for my sister. And then I kept like walking past, you know, like the big bin at Giant. That has like just bags and bags of them. I'm thinking like, man, I want that
Halloween
candy.
Like,
I can't have this in my house. I can't have it in my house. I'll eat it all night. And then I don't buy it, and I still end up eating all night anyway. I still end up eating like a meal at 1 a.m. You know, that's really fucked up.
And that's why this is the Halloween really episode. What?
It's really fucked up.
Is.
I love candy.
Oh.
I love candy so much.
Yeah.
Heavy.
Bored.
Heavy.
I am heavy, heavy, heavy
bored.
The Halloween episode of Heavy Board. I'm Andrew Wittstadt.
I'm Sophie Wiener.
And today we're doing the classic novel Dracula by Bram Stoker. Bram Stoker.
I just call him Bram. Good old Bram.
Oh, yeah. Listeners will know what this is. Dracula. I'm sure you've heard of it. All this good stuff. We have the same version, I believe. We both have Wordsworth Classics.
Yeah, mine, I guess, is newer, maybe. We had, because we both have the Wordsworth Classics, but mine has a different picture on the cover, I think.
Yeah.
Was yours have the castle?
Yeah.
Yeah, you have the Dracula castle. I just have an upside-down bat. I wonder if our pages are the same.
Don't know. For this one, originally, you know, the novel came out in 1897 originally, and then the Wordsworth editions that we have, so we've talked about this before, listeners, the Wordsworth editions are nice, cheap little paperbacks you can get for not much money at all, and they print a lot of the classics, so you can own a copy of this and read through it. Worth buying. But it looks like they published like the first Wordsworth editions of Dracula in 93. And then, like, the notes and introductions kind of added over the year. But over the year 2000, it said, was the last time they added an introduction. At least on the title page. I read through some of the introduction, and listeners know that introductions bore the shit out of me, because they're usually written by academics, and they're boring as shit with, like, bibliographies. So, like, academics don't know how to write introductions to books. They just write, like, research papers and then call it an introduction to books. It's kind of what this one is, although there are some interesting parts to it. Like, I learned some stuff about, like, Stoker's career. All that good stuff. You can, who did your introduction? Is it the same person? I have David Rogers.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Yep.
So we have a nice little introduction that you know, always goes into too much detail about the writer of the book and then the kind of like theories about it. Like this one was a straight up fucking summary, dude. Like where they just straight up did summaries of like, well, there was like a queer theory thought of this in the, you know, the 80s and all. Like it was literally a summary of the last 100 years of Dracula. But yeah, classic, and we're doing this one for Halloween. I figure, why not? Page numbers are pretty much going to be the same. Hopefully, we'll see. But there's that, the additions. All right, fuck, housekeeping. Keep forgetting. Those that don't know, we are looking for workshop horror stories. If you have a workshop horror story you want to share with us, please send that to heavyboardpodcast@gmail.com. We want to get that started. It'll be a lot of fun. We also have a subscription plan. For just a few dollars a month, you can subscribe to this podcast at patreon.com/heavyboard. We oversee full, uncensored, uncut episodes for subscribers only, including bonus episodes. Sophie and I just did a listener Q&A, and you only get access to that if you're a subscriber. So if you don't want to miss that, check that out, patreon.com/heavyboard. If you can't afford that, don't want to do that, there are other ways to support us. You can like, subscribe, share on our YouTube channels, whatever podcast platform you get your podcasts on. You can leave us a 5-star review on Apple or any other platform that allows you to review. That helps us out. Give us a like, give us a share, give us a subscribe. That helps us out. Doesn't cost you anything. If you like this, please support it. I think that's it. That's it for housekeeping. I'm also doing a little treat for listeners, where I'm going to go through a couple different versions of Bram Stoker's Dracula here, movie versions, and that'll be available for subscribers only. So if you want to get that, you should subscribe. Patreon.com/heavyboard. And then send us those workshop horror stories. Heavyboardpodcast@gmail.com. All right, and that's housekeeping. So we went over the type of books, the style, the press, all that bullshit. Initial thoughts, what do we think?
I liked it for like 60 pages. You know me, I love any kind of like horror story, ghost stories, all that stuff. You know, glitter vampires, all the shit. Love it all.
Sparkling vampires, Twilight. Listen to our Twilight episodes, listeners.
I was enjoying this for like the first several chapters, and you know, we were talking about it, kind of fell off for me in the middle, and it just plateaued for me about halfway through and just sort of stayed there pretty much all the way up until the end for me. I really liked the style in which it was written. I really liked that, you know, I mean, it's sort of like, I almost want to describe it like, I mean, it's letters, right? But it almost plays out similar to like found footage, right? At least if you're going by, I guess, the note at the beginning, which is like, you know, referring to all the documents, right?
Oh, yeah.
So we're reading all of the journals and letters and like, telegrams that tell the story of several different characters, and I thought that was cool. I mean, that, you know, that's one of those things where it can be really good or it can be kind of shitty because you're really limited in your character perspective. But yeah, what'd you think?
Yeah, I enjoyed this book. I read it in about 4 days. It kind of flew for me. As Sophie mentioned, it follows a lot of that kind of what you would say the Victorian style ghost story, right? It's very similar to Frankenstein, all that good stuff. I haven't read Jekyll and Hyde, but we should put that on the list.
I haven't read Jekyll and Hyde. I haven't read Frankenstein either.
You never had to read Frankenstein?
Never had to read Frankenstein.
Damn, dude. In undergrad, I think I was assigned Frankenstein like 3 different times in like 3 different classes.
Ugh.
Yeah. But anyway, if you're familiar with any of that, like Sophie and I like ghost stories. We've talked about ghost stories before, and kind of, I'll always say, you know, the best horror ideas and ghost stories came out of the end of the Victorian era right there. If you talk of all the big movie like monsters that we kind of talk about now, and yeah, there's like existence of some monsters, like the vampire lore existed long before the Victorian era, werewolf lore, all that kind of stuff, but like the stories around it that are iconic that we go back to all the time, the ghost stories, the kind of even Agatha Christie style like murder mystery drawing rooms, right, that all stems from this era where we're having the kind of first moments of the Industrial Revolution. And you know, we've talked about this when we talked about other writers, the breaking up of villages, right, more industrious, the cities are growing larger, we're developing a somewhat of a middle class with the Industrial Revolution and all that kind of stuff. And the rich people were just sitting around in these drawing room parlors, right? Mm-hmm. And everybody knows the story how Frankenstein got written and all that kind of stuff, right? It was like a competition. They were sitting around. It was storming. There was nothing to do but sit by the fire and see who could tell the best ghost stories, right? So they would just tell these stories, seances, right? This became very big during the Victorian era and then kind of moved into the modernist era too, right? Like Yeats famously did seances with his wife and shit. Very insane shit. Anybody interested in Yeats?
Yeats, if you look really at his later stuff, occult, generally.
Yeah, exactly. And like kind of towards the end of his life, he went pretty crazy with it, dude. Like he and his wife would literally like do these seances and he would just like rap on the table, do sound effects there with a little rap on the table, and then he would just write these reams of verse unedited and like publish them and claim that they were like the words of God and like the spirits and shit, you know?
Good Lord.
So insane shit, but like there's also like that's ripe with stories, right? Like that's ripe with stories. Good stories. And this is what Dracula follows, that same formula. Dracula was kind of in like the tail end there. I would say the biggest innovation we have in the 20th century that even remotely comes close to what they did in the Victorian era is the zombie innovation, when we started talking about zombies. And that happened around early 20th century, right? The kind of like the Night of the Living Dead and all those kinds of things, like, oh, people being raised up from the dead. But before then, like the ghosts,
what was
Dracula,
the first zombie literature?
I don't know. I mean, I guess you could argue some rising from the dead type thing. Like, shit, we could go, if you really want to argue with it, we go like Bible stories or whatever, people rising from the dead and walking around but being different. I don't know. But actually calling them zombies and like referring to them as like a specific thing, particularly like the viral outbreak storyline that goes with all the zombie lore, was kind of an early 20th century invention off the tail end of these Victorian inventions where they were like Dracula taking like, like I said, the vampire lore existed like through centuries before this, right? Like it was always like a ghost story from medieval times, etc., of like this bloodsucker that can transform into bats. But Dracula by Bram Stoker, it gave him a name. So it gave the vampire a name, and now we have like Dracula. Everybody refers to like a vampire as like a Dracula setting. So this pretty much set the tone for all horror going forward, like in the 20th century, etc. And that's not my argument. I mean, you could find that anywhere in scholarship, and I just tend to agree with it. I mean, what do you think?
I mean, yeah, I think, well, I don't know. Is that something really to argue? Like,
I just argue that, like, the ghost stories peaked, and, like, ghost stories peaked, and then they kind
of... I mean,
yeah,
I think all the biggest examples we have of famous ghost stories or famous monster stories come from that time.
Right, that's what I mean. It, like, right, peaked, yeah, and, like, Dracula was, like, the tail end of that. And I've ghost stories have always been, like, a little kind of, you know, sweet spot for me, where, like, I always appreciate a little ghost, a little supernatural. So I like that that was entering into, like, the mainstream literary scene at the time, all that good stuff. But, yeah, I enjoyed it. Say if you did not, it's set up the same way as like Frankenstein. That's the reason I brought it up, is because Frankenstein has a lot of found letters, right? Letters back and forth from like the doctor, and then like the actual journal of Frankenstein himself when he learns to read and write and play music and all that kind of shit, right? So we plan to do Frankenstein eventually on this too, but again, I know that's one that if you're into books, you've been forced to read probably like 50 times by the time you leave college. So you know, listeners will let us know if you really don't want us to do that or not, but we do plan on doing it eventually, maybe next Halloween or some other ghost ghost related fucking event, monsters, horror, all that good stuff. I've been watching a lot of horror movies, and I know Sophie has too. We've been like, we were just talking about it the other day. Tis the season for horror. Tis the season for fucking Dracula. All right, where do you want to start with this?
I mean, with the only part that I enjoyed, you know.
Yeah. Beginning. So the Harker in the castle.
Yeah, Jonathan Harker.
Yeah, and I noticed that, like, first, when it starts to get that kind of, I've always said this, and we talked about it a little bit so far as we were reading through this last week, Sophie and I, you know, in text and stuff, like, this is kind of pure pulp. Like, I think that's why I liked it so much. Like, the mystery is established kind of right away with Harker going to this strange castle in this strange land. He has to leave from London. And then all of a sudden, when he says he's going to Dracula's castle, all the locals are always kind of like, they're all like, oh, like, don't go there, you know, kind of thing. And like, there's all this kind of mystery around it. The part I underlined is on page 5, bottom of the page. When he gets his like letter to welcome him from Dracula, but at the bottom there, he says, when I asked him if he knew Count Dracula and could tell me anything of his castle, both he and his wife crossed themselves and saying that they knew nothing at all, simply refused to speak further. So you get a lot of that, and it just kind of sets this kind of mystery, like, okay, what, something's up with this. And it doesn't come outright and say he's a vampire, but it uses kind of like the reader's knowledge, preconceived knowledge of what vampires do, garlic, blood sucking, mirrors, all this kind of thing. And they kind of slowly layer that in, or Stoker kind of slowly starts to be like, oh, this, something's wrong about this guy.
Yeah, we get all of that with him approaching the castle. He's like getting on a train. All of these people are flashing crosses at him. They're crossing themselves. They're like staring at him like he's a freak.
But only when they learn that he's going to Dracula's castle as like a solicitor, they call it in here, which I guess is like kind of a lawyer at the time.
Yeah.
Where you would like do stuff for a client, like get the legal paperwork and deeds for houses and purchases and things like that, shipping arrangements, all that kind of stuff. But before we move on, I just wanted to, yeah, this the idea of the letters. So the format of the letters or journals that tell this story, I would say very Victorian ghost style, Frankenstein, etc. What do we think about that? What does it do? We could talk format-wise, just straight up story-wise, entertainment-wise. What do you think?
I mean, it's fun because they have different voices, right? I think it lets you... I guess in some places it does like kind of let you backtrack to see things from a different perspective. Right. So you'll hear about something happening from one character and then we will switch to the voice of another character and they'll recount it as it actually happened. So that's always fun. It also prevents you from getting stuck too much in one character, which I feel like, there are some characters that I would be like, oh, I am fucking sick of this. I got to admit, the two main female characters at first, I was like, oh, my fucking God. Oh, my fucking God. How much longer can this continue? And because you can be in one voice for a really long time. But I do think it keeps it fun. It keeps it maybe... I don't know if it really truly adds to the suspense. I'm sure that, you know, in some way, I'm sure it does. But I think, you know, it keeps certain things maybe withheld in creative ways.
Yeah, there's a suspense.
By switching back and forth.
Yeah, the suspense is between, you get half the story from this one person and you get the other half from another person. So it does add that element of suspense from chapter to chapter type thing, which, yeah.
And
fine
within
technique.
Any one chapter, you can switch between like three different people, or you might switch not at all. Like the first, you know, however many chapters were almost entirely Jonathan Harker. There might have been a little bit. I mean, most of the beginning is Jonathan Harker.
Yeah. First couple chapters are all Jonathan Harker's journal, and then we start getting Mina and Lucy's correspondence. And Lucy. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's where it starts to fall off for me. So not even half, I mean, it's like not barely just, I would say, around page, oh God, you know, where it does start to get fun for me again when Renfield comes into it and we get
with Sword's Dr. Diary. Seward. Yeah. There's this one thing I wanted to laugh at real quick, hold up, before we move on there, because we move through the pace. When he's talking about, like, when he first gets into the castle and Dracula is like, you will need after your journey to refresh yourself by making your toilet. I trust you will find all your wish. And then eventually, like, Harker's just like, I discovered that I was half famished with hunger, so making a hasty toilet, I went into the other room. Making a hasty toilet.
Dump and freshen up.
A hasty toilet. I guess back then that could mean anything from washing your hands and face to taking a dump in the pot, the chamber pot or whatever.
I think so. Well, so. I think my favorite part in these first several chapters is so, like, you know, Jonathan Harker is like quickly realizing that he is somewhere that maybe he doesn't want to be, and it's really creepy. We learn that Dracula has hairy hands, by the way. The palms of his hands are hairy. I thought that was a fun tidbit, because that's just gross. And also that, like, when he sees Dracula leave the castle, he was like, I saw him climbing out the window like a lizard. And it was just such a funny image. Like, I understand that it's, like, supposed to be scary, but, you know, every time he kept saying that he saw Dracula leave like a fucking lizard, I couldn't help but laugh a little bit.
Yeah, and there is a point, it's right in chapter 2, page 24, where I marked it, where he straight up says he feels like a prisoner. The very end of chapter 2. The castle is a veritable prison, and I am a prisoner. And that's how the chapter 2 ends.
Yeah.
And he kind of realizes that he's not allowed to leave, right? The doors are locked. He can't get in. And it's like mysterious, right? Like the mystery is right up fully there.
Yeah.
And then he starts.
Well, and he has to sleep in his bedroom. He's forbidden to sleep anywhere else. But he's like, fuck that. And he goes to, like, sleep in the library. And then he gets approached by, like, three sexy vampire ladies.
Yeah, let's talk about the sexy vampires.
Vampires must be sexy. They must be sexy, except for Dracula, who is. Dude. Entirely unsexy.
Let's talk about that. Let's talk about the not just like the sexiness of those three women that kind of like are trying to seduce him, which I found compelling. I think that was in chapter 3 around page 34 or so. But just this idea of like sexiness and like horror, like the correlation.
Yeah, but just the women. Right now,
just the women.
At least in this book, it's just the women.
Yeah,
the men are like, I mean, Dracula is not described as like a sex bomb. He is like a haggard old man, basically. I mean, they don't call him haggard; they just describe him as like, you know, an old, really super creepy-looking man with like a, you know, pointed beard and mustache and. You don't get the sense that he was, like, ever very attractive. So I found that kind of funny because there's so much emphasis on, like, the hotness of the vampire. Even here, like, even, but just with the women. Just the women.
Yeah. That, I'm going to go into this in our subscribers only episode when I talk about some of the movie adaptations of this novel. Whereas, like, there was a point where, like, they did start to make the male vampire or Dracula character more sexy, but that came later. Like, it's not so much in the novel. Although you could argue he collects women, right? Like, he collects these beautiful young women.
Yeah, well, there is that part. There is a part later in the book where we learn that he is appearing younger than he once was.
Right, as he drinks blood, right. Etc.
So, you know, it's not... It's just, it's an idea left to be explored. But, like, all the women are hot.
And at this time, right, like the Victorian era was a very sexually repressive area, at least in terms of like the prim and proper stuff that they would publish, right? Obviously people were still having sex and all that kind of stuff, but like there was,
yes,
like
there's a lot of, she looked at me very appealingly,
right? Very there was a lot of shame associated with it, those that know the history of that era, right? A lot of pearl clutching, a lot of fainting on couches. But like, I am fascinated by this question. I want to explore it a little bit, like the correlation between sex and horror, and even like sex and gore to a certain extent. There's not really gore in this novel.
There's some like taboo
but,
there, right? Like that's what, like the right. joining of those two things. I feel like there's something taboo about it that it plays into. I don't know. What do you think?
Yeah, I think that there is a strong correlation between, well, because sex is such like a human experience, such a thing that we, I mean, you know, you go back in religions, we treated it as sacred, there were celebrations, right? You could talk about Roman orgies, all that. There was this tied in thing, and then like for some reason it's tied into horror too. I'm fascinated by why, you know, the kind of like this hideous thing, even like gore that's hard to look at or something, you know, like you cringe on when you're watching a movie or something, and then like, but like the person's like naked and like there's like some girl with like huge fake breasts like naked on the screen, and then like they're like cutting her toe off or something, and you're like, oh, it's hard to look at, like, but then like it's, there's also like, it's like kind of, there's tits. Not that it's sexy, yeah, not that it's like, oh, you know, appealing, but it is like there's something that carries the horror. And I was thinking this, you know, biting, just the act of biting another person, like, right, something little kids do, but when you do it as an adult, why do you bite people? I mean, it's a sex thing, right? Like it's like, and then like the biting of the neck, right? Like this area, like the kind of, it's very vulnerable, sensitive, all that kind of stuff, the vulnerability that mixes in with sexual desires, the kind of illogical things that happen. I guess that just ties into horror. I mean, I don't know. I'm just attempting to kind of answer this thing that it kept recurring, especially as I was watching some of the movie adaptations.
Like, yeah, well, and it's also like, playing into sexy. The idea of like evil being tempting.
Right. Okay. Yeah, I like that.
There's some of that,
I like that
too.
Idea. Yeah. Hell yeah. That's definitely there. Definitely there. Listeners can let us know what they think. The correlation between sex and horror. Sex. It is. I think this all the time too. I think about music, right? Sex and music.
It can also just be sensational. I mean, I don't think that's what it's doing here. I think, like, you know, if we were to talk about something like American Horror Story, I think it would be somewhere in between. It's like unsettling and it's sensational.
Yeah, there's like a tantalizing aspect. Like it's like tantalizing you in a way that's uncomfortable. I don't know. Maybe that's it. But yeah, something to think about. And I think that might come back up every time we do a horror thing, because I, for some reason, over the last couple of weeks, I just can't stop seeing it. I've been watching a lot of horror movies and like, you know, getting in the spirit of the season, and there's just this weird sexual element that like is weaved in between all of horror and like the tropes of horror.
All I can see now is fucking Jack Torrance just rubbing his wife's nipples immediately after they fight.
Yeah, little tit jiggling, dude. Yeah, I mean, yeah, and I'm all for it, right? Like, I'm all for it. It's just, it's an interesting thing. I'm sure there's endless scholarship written about this crap, but yeah. And I also thought it was interesting that, like, they use doctors to kind of show how baffling a lot of the cases are, particularly when we get into, like, Lucy's journals and diaries and Mina's letters back and forth to her.
Oh, God, Lucy's are the worst. Lucy's just like, are actually the fucking worst.
And that, and like having a doctor be baffled by something that's happening, like what does that add, you know?
Well, I mean, I think we're taking like someone that we're supposed to trust, right?
Supposed to be knowledgeable, a healer.
Knowledgeable,
right?
And trustworthy.
Supposed to solve.
So if they're stumped, we should all be scared, right?
Right, yeah.
Like if the doctor doesn't know what's going on. But then we do have one doctor who does seem to know what's going on.
Where he suspects.
Yeah.
Where we get, what do we think of Van Helsing? As Van Helsing starts to come in here as we learn more and more.
Yeah, I think he knows kind of immediately. And he's just not willing to put all of his eggs in that basket from the jump. Like, he doesn't want to freak them out, so he doesn't say, this is what I suspect. But he sort of unveils it slowly.
That, and because they would think he was crazy, right? They put him in a madhouse if he was this well-respected professor of medicine that is talking about bloodsuckers and, like, fantasy stuff. People are going to laugh at him, right? He's going to lose his titles, his position, his respect. So he has to, like, carefully break it to Sword and all that. But I viewed it, I wrote down in my notes here that, like, when we get to that point where we get introduced to Van Helsing and Mina and Lucy, it's almost like Mina and Van Helsing are playing, like, the role of a detective in, like, a pulp style.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think Mina, Van Helsing, and Seward, all three of them, are like the detectives. And maybe, you know, even Jonathan Harker later kind of becomes a sidekick also when Quincy P. Morris, or what the fuck ever his name is. And yeah, they're all solving it together, but it's really like Van Helsing is sort of leading the charge, and then there's Mina who's sort of by his side, and yeah, I guess those are the two main ones, and Seward is kind of helping them along.
And Seward's the skeptical one because he's a doctor of mental health, right? He runs a sanitarium where we get Renfield and all that. So he's like the one that's like, well, everybody has delusions, you know, like there are delusions that we can diagnose and help treat. But so he like has to like, part of the reason Van Helsing has to be so delicate is because Seward, as we learn, is his former student, would be skeptical of him saying, oh, there's a blood-sucking vampire that can morph into bats and wolves and control and hypnotize people and lure them out of their homes, their bedrooms, all that kind of thing. I say that too is like that's kind of sexual, right? Like the fact that Dracula can lure Lucy, who's supposed to be this gorgeous young woman, in her nightgown, right? Because it's Victorian era, so in her like
nightie. Well, I mean, it's also. Yeah, it's a guy who sneaks into your room at night while you're sleeping.
And bites your neck, and you let him kind of thing. Like, yeah, like, so there is this level of, like, yeah, sexual taboo maybe is the best way to put it. Like Sophie said, that kind of ups the ante, ups the escalation kind of stuff. The tension, the thriller aspect, the pulp discovery detective like thing that I got out of this, like that made me keep kind of propelling through this. This book isn't terribly long. This book's like 300 pages, right? So it's kind of an average length novel. It's not like, you know, 500, 600, 800 page novel. It's pretty standard. And there are parts there, like you said, when like Lucy and Mina get introduced with their letters back and forth, the pace does slow down a little bit.
Like
it slows down because
so much
we just had Harker.
It slows down so much. It's so much of the book. It goes on for so fucking long. Okay, you say your bit now.
Yeah. Well, like, because we get Harker's discovery and he discovers he's a prisoner and then he makes his fucking escape, right, eventually. And, then we get introduced to Mina and Lucy, who we learn, we don't know yet when they first get introduced, but we learn through
Lucy's
their letters.
Just so in love.
Yeah.
And it's all that. That's like so much of their letters. It's, I'm so in love.
Right. That they're tied into to Harker and some of these other people that come up. But yeah, it does throw the pace off a little bit when the women come in and start talking about how they want to be proposed to and don't you think he's a fine young man? Would you want to marry him? Blah, blah, blah. Like their letters back and forth. Does throw off the pace some until we get to Seward and his kind of crazy Renfield patient that is.
It's also deeply uninteresting.
Yeah, we can skip over a lot of that. But yeah, lots of like, and then when we find out that like Lucy's having issues and like we find out that she's a vampire.
Yeah, finally, like Lucy's falling ill. right? Lucy is... I feel like it all kind of starts coming to a head around, what is it, like chapter 12?
Yeah, around chapter 12, and then chapter 14 is where we find out that she's straight up a vampire. Like, they find her, like, luring those kids in the graveyard and shit.
The blue fur lady.
The white lady in the graveyard that's, like, luring children or whatever.
Yeah, so basically what happens is we learn that Lucy's falling ill. We know that her mom is also dying. Not because of any kind of vampire shit, but just because she's old and sick and she's dying.
It's a heart condition, yeah.
And so everyone's being very careful to not shock her because, my God, we could shock her to death. But as Lucy becomes sick, you know, no one can figure it out. So who is it? Is it her husband-to-be that calls on Dr. Seward, or is it the other doctor that's like tending to her? I don't remember.
I don't remember either, but I just, Seward is the one who calls Van Helsing because he can't figure it out. And then that's when Van Helsing is like, oh, she's has a severe lack of blood. That's why she's like dizzy and not being able to stand.
Yeah,
and can
she's
only
super
sleep.
Pale. She can only sleep. Yeah.
So they have to do these blood transfusions, and that's always good stuff where they're doing these fucking blood transfusions from one person's arm to the other. I guess my fucking, my modern contemporary brain is always like, how could they do that? We don't even know what blood type it is. Like, it could kill her. Like, yeah. That's what I was like
but
thinking.
But they're all
like,
just switching off.
Yeah.
Like three men.
But I guess that in blood types were not a thing yet. But yeah, I thought that was a good escalation, having Lucy become kind of like a vampire and then have her die.
God, but it takes so fucking long, dude.
Yeah.
But yeah, we have all that happen. Finally, Lucy gets sick. We learn, like, we get all these hints, you know, we hear like a bat tapping at her window. We get all a lot of these allusions to like, oh, well, don't let her sleep with the window open. Van Helsing comes and puts, you know, what he calls flowers around her neck, but it's really garlic.
Garlic flowers.
Yeah.
Right. The flowers that grow out of the ground where the garlic grows underneath the ground, right? Like onions, that potatoes, all those types of like things that grow in the ground. But yeah, and I thought it was a good escalation. It was a good escalation of the tension. It keeps the mystery going to the point where, okay, we're pretty much aware that this is a vampire, and then Lucy dies, and they have to do all this elaborate shit to kill her, right? Because she's a fucking
undead
vampire.
Yeah, and keep in mind,
vampire.
We are so far into the book. We're like, I mean, what, chapter 12 is like about halfway through the book, and I don't know if at this point we've even used the word vampire.
No, they don't use the word vampire until very late in the book. I marked chapter 14, page 161. Is where I, when they find out that, very end of chapter 14, where, in God's name, Professor Van Helsing, what do you mean? I cried. He threw himself with a despairing gesture into a chair and placed his elbows on the table, covering his face with his hands as he spoke. They were made by Miss Lucy. In terms of their, like, the kids, right? They find these kids that have these marks in their neck, and they're like, dead or their blood is gone, and it's all they figure out it was Lucy. But this aspect of the letters, this gets back to it too, with this kind of like the urgent messages and letters that they're like, oh, an urgent telegram, that's like the only way you could communicate, right? And then there's the aspect where the Stoker clarifies that they aren't read, so this is a letter that nobody's seen
or they're delivered late,
right? So they don't get them in time. Yeah. And this adds a ticking clock element, right? So those of our craft listeners, they care about the craft of writing, and this would be a fiction element, right? Adding
and that's
that
intermittent.
Clock.
It's not just letters either, right? It's also a diary. A lot of it is just diary entries.
Yeah. But the letters specifically, like the urgent messages that are like, you have to know this. And of course, they don't get to Sword in time, or they don't get to Van Helsing in time. And then, of course, it's too late for Lucy and all this kind of stuff. Something goes wrong in the plan. And that adds, again, the suspense, thriller, pulp element to it. But yeah, Hold on, I gotta pee real quick, and then I want to talk about Lucy and why all the men are obsessed with her. Again, going back to that, like, sexual horror shit. Had to make a hasty toilet.
A hasty one or a hasty two?
A hasty one.
Hasty yellow. Yeah, so what's up with these men and Lucy?
Lucy and Mina after Lucy's dead.
Yeah.
All these men protecting these vulnerable young vaginas. They're just being protected by these men who claim to play that
these
literally
men with
pledge
their man brains.
Yeah, there's a lot of that. Like where they're like, Mina, you have a man's brain, I swear, Mina. what the fuck was I gonna say? And then not just that, they pledge their life to it. Like these men are willing to die. Not just for Mina and Lucy, but they say to like fight the evil, right? But like I think like that's an element too, right? Not so much like the damsel in distress type thing, but like that is a horror element. Like most horror movies have a vulnerable young woman at the center somewhere. Usually. Most horror stories, tropes. Weird kind of, I guess maybe it's like a romantic thing, like the love element to justify character actions. But I thought tying all the men to Lucy, interesting choice. What do we think?
I don't know. It's all always weird to me. I mean, it's hard, like, it's just like, it seems like Seward and Van Helsing in particular, it's just them, right? Because, like, the other two men love their loved ones, right? Jonathan Harker loves Mina. And Arthur, whose name changes at some point, and he becomes Lord Godalming or whatever.
Right.
But he loves Lucy and like no one else, right? They each have their significant other.
Well,
but these other two men.
Isn't it Quincy Morris who is engaged to Lucy?
Quincy? No, Quincy isn't he one of the people that tries to become engaged to Lucy,
but is
Arthur
rejected.
Is the one that wins. Right. And so is Seward. Seward is also in love with Lucy.
Right, that's what I mean, dude. Everybody's in love with
this beautiful
young woman.
Yeah, everyone's in love with Lucy. And that's
even
sort
Van
of,
Helsing
okay. I kind of
says,
forgot about that. Yeah. Everyone's fucking in love with Lucy. She writes to Mina and she's like, oh, I was proposed to 3 times this week.
Right. And they're giving her blood, so they're like putting themselves inside of her type thing. Like there's the stress of that symbolic.
Oh yeah. And the husband to be doesn't know either that the other two men had to step in for him.
Had to put their things inside of her,
they had to get in there.
Put some blood.
Make it wet.
Open a hole and insert a needle.
Yeah, so it's all very sexy, very, very fun.
And it's there
while she's laying there, unable to respond.
And they keep lots of kissing of the head, lots of kissing and of like the sweaty forehead and things like that. And I don't know.
But then it's really fun when they describe how gross she is when she sleeps.
Yeah.
Like. Her lips just keep peeling back to reveal her teeth. I'm like, ugh. Oh, open mouth sleeper. But yeah, I don't know. I guess like that's just to make us feel like Lucy is something special.
Yeah.
That all of these men love her, but it really doesn't do anything except say, oh, she's like a sweet, beautiful woman.
It brings
like,
all of these people.
We know very little about Lucy's personality except that she is excited to get married.
Yeah. But in a story structure element, Lucy is the catalyst to bring Van Helsing, Sword, Quincy, Arthur, Harker, Mina, all of them. She's the link that like gets all of them to come together. And that's where I kind of got this like vibe as the story progresses and they realize they have to do something. It's almost like I said chapter 18, page 196-ish. Let me flip to there. Where like we kind of learn.
My first note for chapter 18 is, she looked so appealing and so pretty. I could not refuse her.
Exactly.
Let me find what page that is. I was also listening to the audiobook off and on, so I don't always have the page marked. I will say the Audible audiobook is pretty good. It's got like I think Alan Cumming reads Dr. Seward and like Tim Curry is maybe Dracula and like Harker the beginning. It's fun.
Yeah, but when I got into chapter 18 is like, this is after the death. This is after where they realize that they're going to have to like be all together because they're fighting this undead guy who's super strong. It's almost like this kind of gathering of the team, that this gathering of like the Marvel superheroes to fight a great evil, right? Like this kind of everybody has to come and do their part. They have their special skills, even though I guess Arthur or the Lord, what's his name, is just his only superpower is being... Is being rich. That's like his superpower or whatever. That's what he brings to the team, money for the expenses they need. But I found that very compelling, this kind of like getting the team together to fight this great evil.
Is this when Mina is talking to Dr. Seward's patient who like, you know, eats pets basically is his thing. He like eats animals, right?
It's right when, I think it's past that, because I think it's right where Van Helsing is basically like, look, like we have a vampire here, and kind of everybody is finally willing to admit that that's not a crazy thing to say, but they have to be careful because everybody else is going to think they're crazy. And but we get this kind of moment after they've gathered everybody at Seward's hospital that like they need to like, they all just kind of make like, agree that yeah, it's a vampire. Like, kind of everybody kind of sort of admits vampires are real. And I think this is where having a doctor and a professor and a lord and all these people, like, where it was a good choice to make this kind of believable. Because now we have a doctor, like Sylvie said, this kind of authority figure, this professor, admitting and telling people that actually, yes, this is true, that we researched this and this is what it is. So it kind of adds to the believability. But I mean, at this point, we're like 200 pages into a 300 page book about vampires. So you kind of believe it anyway. But I thought that was like just a good way to do it.
Yeah. So we have our team.
And right. Because everybody has to be persuaded. And it would make sense, right? Like if we're in a fantasy novel, right? Like people have to be persuaded. A fantasy story, you have skeptical characters. It's almost like a trope in like the way it's laid out. But I had a question here where I was like, all right, how much do ghosts / horror stories, right, rely on kind of legend or lore?
I mean, I think it depends on the story, right? You mean legend that they build into like... that already exists before the story is written. I mean,
like
probably
the folklore
a fair
stories.
Bit.
Yeah.
But I think it also depends. But yeah, I would say probably most horror comes from some fucking folklore.
Yeah, and there's right? the folklore, especially at this time when everybody was getting educated, right? Like we know what folklore is, which is like it's kind of like myths, right? Stories, legends. These things that we know that probably aren't true, but there's like this doubt of certainty in the reader about it. And then like it's used to like the story's advantage. Like what I mean is like, you know, if people don't believe in ghosts or supernatural things, how does the horror story use that to, you know, kind of use that to like kind of have like this fear or doubt to its advantage? So it kind of uses the disbelief of what most people would say about ghosts or i.e. vampires, and then like uses that to the advantage of the story, to like that doubt of the reader and making them believe. Like you have to like make them believe by using these things that are in the back of their head. We talked about this a little bit. What episode was it? Was it the Flynn episode where we just kind of got on the ghost subject for a little while?
I don't know.
Like that idea maybe. Of like, you know, if you don't believe in ghosts, but you're still afraid of ghosts, that Edith Wharton quote, where like, there's this doubt, right? That there's this, you're like, oh, ghosts aren't real, but then there's this possibility, like maybe they are real, kind of thing. And that's like a trope. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely a trope, but we learn immediately, right? Like that vampires are real. We learn it right away. Because we see it in John Harker's diary. So I don't think that we as the reader really have to feel any doubt. We just have to watch the characters come to terms with it. And that's the thing, we're grappling with it. It's like, how quickly will these characters come to terms with the fact that this is a real threat?
Yeah, and what I'm getting at more in that question is like the doubt. So like if we say that ghosts aren't real, but there's this little bit of doubt in the back of our head, everybody that's so sure, right? There's this little ping of doubt.
You mean us as a reader, like, is it supposed to make us fearful because even though we supposedly doubt, like assuming that we as the reader doubt the existence of vampires or ghosts or whatever. Like, I mean, I think it would have to, well, because I was, you know, horror isn't necessarily about being realistic either. I was gonna say, is, you know, is he trying to make it realistic enough that we're
not
gonna doubt
realistic,
our own belief? But I don't think that's it either.
Not realistic, but like that you have to believe the fantasy, right? So you have to earn the belief in
but
the
I
fantasy.
Also think there is less horror here than there is maybe thrill.
Yeah, well, same thing with
like,
thrill, right? You have
you
to
know,
believe like what they're putting in front of you to make the thrill, like the drama,
like,
the tension
think,
that's leading up to it.
Yeah, it feels more like a Scooby-Doo investigation than a, you know, it does one of like Edith Wharton's ghost stories, which I would say some of which are scarier.
Yeah. I just, it's this inherent doubt that's being exploited, right? Like this kind of, there's this doubt inherent because we can't say for certain, although some people would argue we can say for certain, right? Because we have no proof.
Right. The default position is that we don't believe. We're expected right. not to be believers.
Right. And then a novel or a good story or a good movie lets you suspend that disbelief, right? I guess they call it a willful suspension of disbelief, but like a great trope uses that little bit of doubt that maybe we're so certain that it's unreal. They exploit that little bit of doubt that's in the back of your mind to make you believe and follow through. And like Sophie said, they use kind of thriller elements, ticking clock, right? Ticking clock.
Well,
keeps being
again,
brought up.
Like our, you know, some of our central characters, it's not like we just have like a priest who's leading the charge, right? We have a doctor, we have men of science.
Well, that's why I brought that up, because I think that was where it was happening, right? We were reaching a point, and not just culturally, where science was revealing a lot of the mysteries of the world to us, right?
Yeah, and they
science
refer to,
advancing.
Like, you know, this age of enlightenment, right?
Yes.
They refer to the enlightenment. And
so,
you know,
they're trying to consciously subvert, like, our educated expectations, I think, is
yeah.
what it does. And I think you can use that to the advantage or disadvantage of any given story. But
well, yeah, and they're presented as, like, educated people, too. Like, even Mina, you know, she, like, is like, I'm keeping a diary. She's, like, very investigative. She does a lot of problem solving for the group.
She's almost like a secretary,
of course it's
right?
When, yeah, and it's when she's with, she goes to see Seward's patient because Seward, they're all together and Seward gets called back to the hospital because something's up with his patient and everyone else is like, we want to come too. So now they've like solidified as a group and he's like, oh, okay. Mina comes in, she wants to talk to Renfield, Seward's patient. And Renfield lets us know that clearly Mina's a bit pale and perhaps is not doing so great. And that's when they all look at each other and they're like, oh, shit. So they discover that Mina too is under the influence of a vampire.
Yeah, and then Mina takes on the role of like damsel in distress.
But yeah, but she is and she isn't, right? She's like a more active. She isn't quite a Lucy here, right? Like she is an active member of this, like, you know, Scooby-Doo group. And she's still doing a lot of the work to guide them. And we can talk about that a little bit more.
What did you want to... Yeah?
There's so much God. But yeah, so she gets her baptism, right? So we find out that Mina has been getting her neck sucked on. And they decide that, you know, we're all going to stay in the same place and someone's going to watch you. And yeah, Van Helsing does this like thing where he pulls out a crucifix and he presses it to her forehead and her forehead burns. And now she has a crucifix burn on her forehead.
And this is after we learn that Mina is getting tempted through these kind of dreams that she describes in her diary, like these kind of dreams that we see. And it always fascinates me, like this kind of use of dreams. And I wanted to ask about like kind of why,
or like this trance state.
Yeah. And the hypnotizing. Yeah. Like the hypnotizing and all that. Right. This goes with the seances.
There's a lot of hypnosis.
Yeah.
So, yeah, Van Helsing keeps hypnotizing her to try to read her mind or get her to, like, say what she has seen through this, like, she apparently has, like, this sort of Harry Potter-like access to Dracula.
They're connected because she's drank his blood, yeah.
yeah. It does have a very Harry Potter kind of Voldemort thing going on. Like, oh.
Yeah. Or you could say Harry Potter has a Dracula thing going on.
Yeah, I mean, it's
considering
true.
It was like 100 years after Dracula was published. But yeah, like this idea of dreams. So why do dreams work so well in horror or fiction more generally?
Oh, because we don't know what to make of them. Right? I mean, because there's so much left to interpretation, because after so many years we still haven't figured out precisely what dreams are about, because they're mysterious. We hardly remember them except when we have nightmares, right?
A lot of times they're nonsense, right? That they don't make sense.
You know, there's a plenty of history of people saying that they've had like prophetic dreams, right?
That, and you could go back to even like ancient cultures, right, where they talked about like demons and things and like spirits that could come to you while you're asleep. It's considered like a connection to the spiritual side of the world when you're kind of like in your unconscious state of sleeping. I think that could be, maybe that's why horror exploits it so well.
You're also vulnerable in sleep.
Premonitions, yeah, like this kind of, there's so many different ways to do it. And maybe that's why, because it's just such a useful tool in terms of like crafting a story around. Or adding that element of mystery.
It can be fun, right? It's like a dream, like, you know, adding dreams is like a whole fucking playground. Because you can make anything happen. And, you know, you can make anything happen.
Yeah. It's like a good, like Sophie said, it's a good way to like play, think of it as a playground. And you can go the other way with this, right? So if you lean too hard into that, well then you start going to the danger of the dream not making sense, not just to the character, but like not making sense to your reader either. Like there has to be like a tie up. But
yeah, but I think it's used well here. I don't think it's like especially exciting the way it's used. I think it's just like a plot device that allows them to get information they wouldn't otherwise have access to.
Yeah.
Right. And that keeps us like concerned for Mina.
Especially when we go into the realm of like being able to communicate with other characters in dreams. So if you're connected to Dracula and Mina, right? It's like a window into I don't know, like another state of mind or something that can be used.
Yeah. And, you know, they, well, and sleep is also, I mean, this isn't about dreams, right? But it's also the thing in the book that makes everyone vulnerable, including the vampires, right? It's where everyone is the most vulnerable. So, like, when they kill Lucy, finally, after they realize that she's what they call the we get, you know, this little newspaper clipping that's like, oh, the Bloofer lady, all these kids are disappearing. They're going to play with the Bloofer lady, they say. And we find out that, you know, she's luring all of these kids. And, you know, they go and find her in her coffin while she's sleeping. And they kill her, right?
Drive a stake through the heart and cut off the head to ensure she's dead.
Yeah, and fill her mouth with garlic.
Oh, yeah. That severed head, like you're roasting it.
Yeah, we learned that also, like, in this world, vampires can do fucking everything, right? Except travel in daylight, I guess. But they can, like, fit through impossibly small spaces and are super strong.
He can turn into a mist, almost. Yeah.
Yeah.
Super strength.
Can turn into animals. They might not just turn into bats. They can turn into other things.
Transfiguration.
Yeah. Well, we get this scene at the zoo with some wolf, right? That's breaking out of the zoo.
Harry Potter. Harry Potter. Harry Potter can transfigure. Oh, Potter. Mr. Potter. You cannot change into a toad. Yeah. Harry Potter must go home.
Fucking Dobby, dude.
Yeah, dude. Fuck Dobby. I wanted to ask.
There's a lot of references for good brave men. Mina, yes. It has a man's brain. There's a lot about men's brains.
The male and female brain.
How faith is our only anchor. That's much later in the book. But yeah, that keeps happening. Apparently, I thought in chapter 18, Alan Cumming was ridiculous reading Seward's journal. You should check it out, man.
What was I going to say? The oaths. We talked about this a little bit. This kind of like oath making when we said to Lucy.
You have my oath, sir.
Right. I pledge my life to you. Blood oaths. Like this kind of, it is a trope, right? Sophie and I were texting a little bit about
happens
this, but this
so fucking much in this book. As soon as Lucy dies, Arthur and Mina are like, I pledge myself as your sister. And he's like, oh, and won't you, you know, and will you let me be your brother? And there's like, you know, all of this like good feeling, yah bullshit, right? Where they have this companionship now that they've decided they have in an instant. Literally doesn't build up over time. It's like, ooh, we both got scared. Now we're besties. But it works.
Yeah, because they're, and that's why like the oaths, like the binding agreements. And so I said, yeah, like when there is this level of, if you survive something, right? I think there's a name for this. I don't know my psychology terms that well, but there's a name for that, right? When like somebody saves you or you experience a traumatic event with
trauma
somebody.
Trauma bonding.
There is a connection, right? Like there is like, you are immediately connected because you just went through something, like whether you're total strangers on a train or something, right? Like, and you just go through some traumatic thing. I don't know what it is, whatever it is, you're suddenly bonded in this way. Right. But this goes a little bit further in terms of, we have the vocalized pledges. Like there's a scene, and this is later in the novel when they realize they have to chase Dracula because they have him on the run. and like they all kind of gather around Mina and they figure out, oh, she's being hypnotized by Dracula, she's being, you know, sucked dry by him type of thing, and she's sucking him dry and everybody's sucking each other and very sexy. Yeah. And then they
everyone's so appealing. Everyone's looking at each other very appealingly.
Sucking and fucking and sucking and fucking. Harry Potter. But they do.
Yeah,
have
there's no Stephen King style gangbang that's gonna go down here.
Yeah,
as we've discussed.
Peter,
I was
talking about that yesterday. Yeah, Stephen King's like 12-year-old gangbang in the sewers.
Yeah,
but
nothing wrong with that, you know. Just a 12-year-old gangbang in the sewers. It's normal. Normal
but,
part of growing up.
This idea of oaths, and there's this big scene where they all gather around Mina when they know she's a vampire, and they all kind of one by one pledge, not just like they like that they're like loyal to her, they're gonna help her end
this.
They're
gonna put their dicks in her. They pledge
Harry
their swords.
Potter? Putting his penis in the, but
that's a whole other world. We can do a whole episode on Harry Potter fan fiction if you want.
Oh, the banging. I've never read Harry Potter fan fiction, but I imagine it's just like all other fan fiction, which is terrible.
Just different characters banging each other. Yeah.
Yeah. Just like
it's all
fucking.
It is.
Yeah. But they all like basically like pledge their life that they're willing to see this through to the end. And there is something compelling in that. And this kind of, what is it about oaths or like commitments in stories that work so well?
Well, they have to be committed, right? Or else if it gets too hard, they're all going to be like, well, shucks. Oh, gee whiz. Didn't work out.
Yeah.
Although it might be more exciting if one of them like was like, oh, fuck this, I'm out of here, and like ran off. I honestly think that would have made for a more exciting story. But yeah, I mean, it's sort of like we need to have this like central crew. Like they don't really become a team until halfway through the book or more. Right? Where they start doing things for each other. They start really working together. Mina starts typing up all of John Seward's diaries that he has entered in his phonograph.
It's when
which I also
want to
come back
admit,
to.
Yeah.
There's a lot about like the phonograph and shorthand, and like everyone, especially Mina, is really fascinated with how easy we can make note taking. The available technologies of note taking, like she routinely keeps mentioning it later on when they're chasing Dracula by boat. She's like all hype about the traveling typewriter. Like there's all this shit.
Technology making it easier. Yeah.
Yeah. There was a big emphasis on that as well. Did that do anything for you? I mean, I guess it did make sense in terms of like, yeah, I mean, in terms of the, first of all, the way that this story is presented to us, right? It's all right. It's all letter writing pretty much, or diary writing, right, or telegrams. And they're all avid note takers, right? We have like two doctors. We have Jonathan Harker, who keeps a diary. Mina, who keeps a diary because, I don't know, I guess her husband does, and somehow now she's compelled to do it too. Is really like proud of herself for being able to write in shorthand, and then becomes really impressed by Seward's phonograph.
Yeah, I really don't know shorthand as much because we don't really use it anymore, but I know we do still use shorthand style. It's almost like a different language. Yeah, we're use it in like legal stenographers now. They're like the only people that still do it.
Yeah.
Because we have computers, so you can type faster than you could ever write with a pen and paper type thing.
Yeah, I mean, we also just have like voice recognition, right?
Voice
we
recorders
like AI
now and all
that,
yeah.
Or like shit that would just go audio to text for you, so you wouldn't even have to listen to something to type it up.
Yeah. So there's only like a few people, but that was something they used to teach all women, right? Like that, if you went to like a finishing school. You know,
yeah,
that's what it is.
And I don't know if we mentioned this, but like there is also the added, like we know that after Harker initially goes to see Dracula in those first chapters, when he returns, he doesn't return for some time because he's ill. Like at the end of his chapters, I was surprised to learn that he was not dead. Right.
Harker.
So he he becomes really ill and stays at some hospital, some foreign hospital before coming home.
Oh, right, right. Yeah, that's way into the, because that's in the very beginning, or at least like the first section that was in the very journal ends.
Yeah, so they know it's like,
because we introduce Mina, where like Mina gets a letter from a foreign hospital where Harker just appeared, because last we saw him, he was desperately trying to escape from Dracula's castle, and then he just appears. They think he's crazy, he's in a hospital, he's ill, blah blah blah, so probably had his blood drained or something like that.
So we know that they know that they're going into danger, and they also have all of his journals, so they read his journals and they're like, oh shit. And then we spend the next fucking, I don't know how many chapters, dude, it feels like forever. Well, that they're chasing Dracula.
Yeah, well, that's like the whole thing, right? They're going to get this, the villain, right? They have to all swear this oath. But like still staying on like the recording, the writing type thing. I mean, phonograph was brand new, right? This was the end of the 19th century when Edison first invented it. And they describe it in the book, and it's the old style phonograph. It's not like a record player like we were accustomed to. This is still very early wax cylinders that would melt if they got too hot. Yeah, you have to crank it. Not very good quality recordings. They were pressing the sound into the wax disc, but it was not what we could, like how we press records today, or even in the 70s and 60s and 50s. But there's that. Anybody that's interested in that, it's a very interesting history on like the phonograph and the kind of evolution of like sound recording, which all happened really at the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century. I like a lot of like, this is some nerdy shit, but I like a lot of like old blues records. And I'm saying like old blues, like, yeah, like 1920s and shit. Like, what's his name? I didn't want to say it. It's not Charlie Parker. Charlie Patton. Charlie Patton's one of my favorites. He's one of the kind of big Delta blues godfathers. You know, his recordings are so hard to listen to now because they were recorded on a shitty phonograph, you know, one track. He was basically playing live and they're recording him. So it's terrible quality. It cracks, like the voice isn't regulated. The high and low levels all crackle when they get too high or too low. But, you know, it was the only way to preserve a lot of all that music and all that kind of stuff happening back then. But
I think a more interesting thing is like that everyone's compelled to, you know, and it's not just the doctors, right? Everyone's compelled to like keep note of what they see, keep some record of what they see. And they like, you know, there's talk of like empirical minds, right? And like, you know, you have to, now that we've all seen it, we believe it, and keeping all these records of what they have seen, just sort of makes it more compelling, I think.
Yeah.
Or interesting that they are so compelled. But, like, it's also at a moment where it's like, yeah, that was the thing.
Well, that's the thing, too. So, like, this reason is this oath, these binding agreements, and, like, what it does is, yeah, it compels characters to act when they would rather not. And we see this when Van Helsing is consecrating the graves of Dracula and the women that Dracula keeps around. So like, you know, he's like doesn't want to do it, he's terrified and then horrified at what he has to do, but he keeps doing it anyway because he's sworn this oath to protect Mina and everybody else, and I guess you could argue himself too, right? Because it's quite a bit of danger if you don't follow through on this. Like, he's going to die. Like,
right,
they're going to kill him. So there is this level of like, oaths give us a reason, or give the characters a reason, give us a plot point in the story to justify actions that we would be like, why would anybody do this? Why would you risk your life in that regard? And there's just something about swearing. I don't know. Like, swear. Like, this is. Sophie and I talked about this a little bit, where we kind of swear on Bibles, right? We take oaths before we testify things. We still do. You swear on the Constitution or something. If I teach in a state where they make me take an oath to the Constitution of the state, when I work, because I'm technically a state employee, right? I don't know if it's a red state thing or what, but yeah, there was like a paper I had to sign. I had to basically just say pledge an oath to the to uphold the Constitution of the state of Nevada. Is essentially, I think all state workers have to do it. So it's like something like that. I never had to do that in Louisiana or Maryland, but yeah, I don't know. There's just things like that where it creates this kind of binding, where it's almost like we put them into law, right? Like, these oaths are part of the law now. And it's like, do you swear you're telling the truth, so help you God, right? It's like, I don't know, maybe it's like a deferring to a higher power, or like a...
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot of that in this book, right? Like, well, if we can believe in this, you know. I mean, there's so much reference to God, dude. Like, Mina and Jonathan Harker in particular are especially religious, it would seem.
Well, it's the Victorian age.
Yeah, and that's pretty well established pretty early on. So they're also trying to do right by God. That's also a lot of this. Is that, you know, the power of Christ compels them.
Yeah, and you think of, like, the horror that came out all around that time. It was very... Because they were, it was like a supernatural power. The only other supernatural power you could refer to would be, yeah, like the myths, traditions, legends of what they call God, and mostly the Christian religion. But everyone has their myths about it, so that makes sense from a storytelling perspective. And you see all this horror, right? Like crosses, holy water,
garlic.
This one spirit. Well, yeah, but garlic.
Garlic isn't exactly holy.
The crucifixes and stuff.
Wonder what that comes from.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, you go by garlic, like the way people use garlic, like all the time. I mean, dude, if you look at some of these homeopathy, like Facebook groups and shit, dude, some of these like hippie people are just like thinking that onions and garlic like break fevers and shit if you like put them in the bath, like with you or. So, yeah, I don't know. I guess because it's just so pungent and it does clear your sinuses. If you were to like bite into a whole clove of garlic or something, like you could clear out congestion. Or I don't know if it was used in like medicine, probably, right? It's still used in medicine, right? Garlic things where you say take a garlic supplement to lower your cholesterol. I don't know. I mean, I guess it's just the traditional use of this kind of very flavorful, sometimes almost too much flavor when you're just like biting into garlic, right? It's like overwhelms everything. Yeah. You can smell it on people when they've eaten too much garlic, right? And they're just like sweating out garlic. It's like everything's tinged with garlic.
Love,
like you smell it.
I fucking love garlic so much.
Yeah, I mean, me too. It's delicious. But,
it's great.
Yeah, I don't know. But so, there is this like, so okay, this big spirit is going to fight this other evil spirit. So it is within the religious context of like storytelling.
Oh, well, yeah.
Right?
I mean, they're going around. So the big thing, right? They need to consecrate the ground that he sleeps on, right? So when Dracula is like, I'm going to move to London, he has to have all of his, you know, coffins filled with earth delivered.
The dirt he was buried in, yeah.
Yeah. And he has like a bunch of coffins. And
he's
the way
had
that
hundreds
they're going
of years to prepare.
Deal with this is they're going to place a wafer in the coffin.
Yeah. What they refer to in the Christian religion as the Eucharist, right? So the symbolic body of Christ, the wafer that the priest blesses and says this is the body of Christ, and then people eat it symbolically, right? So
terrible
that
flavor
is enough. Yeah, it's usually. Usually flavorless. Yeah, yeah. It's like literally like air.
Yeah. It's a shame.
Yeah. You could just munch on them. If you had like a bag of like the little wafers they make for churches. Yeah. I've been to whenever there's like a lot of people, like an impromptu mass or like a graduation mass or something when I was younger and had to go to them, they were like, if they didn't have enough wafers, they would just like tear up loaves of bread and just like have them be like blessed in the ceremony and pass those out. So I guess what they used to do before there was like a wafer factory that like made them with a little cross imprinted in them.
All that stuff, but yeah.
But yeah, they need to do that, and they know that he has several boxes. Dracula knows that the team is on to them, so he's going to flee. But they can only find so many of his boxes, so he takes his last box with him. His last coffin. Yeah.
Well, they determine, and this is one of the details they determine in terms of, like, detective, the whole team coming together, right? They all have these missions that they have to complete because there are boxes all over the country in England because he was moving there. They discover he has almost 50 boxes, right, that are moved to various locations. They have to hunt them down through various solicitors, right? This is where they use that one guy's money, Arthur's money, to, like, help them track this and, like, pay off, like, you know, customs agents at shipping harbors and stuff to find out where these boxes went, and like then they have to destroy them, right? So they burn them, they destroy them, all that kind of stuff, while just to like make sure, kind of like Sophie keeps bringing in the Harry Potter stuff, but yeah, like essentially like the Voldemort horcruxes, right? Like they have to just destroy these things so you can't reincarnate
so that he has nowhere to go.
Yeah. And you know, I mean, that's fun. I was thrilled. Like I said, I read this in like 4 days. Like,
I was kind of like, bored by that part. I was like, okay, let's move forward. I want some real Dracula action, right? Because, I mean, at this point, we haven't seen Dracula in so many fucking chapters, right? Like, we haven't seen him since like chapter 4 or some shit. We're on chapter like, you know, 24 at this point. Somewhere there.
We haven't like seen him or his correspondences, but we have
hear Dracula's about
still
him.
The thing driving everybody else.
So we have a minor driving the plot. You know, encounter with him when we hear the story about the wolf at the zoo, right?
The wolves. We didn't even talk about the wolves, dude.
Yeah, so he has a thing
the
for
gypsies.
Wolves.
The gypsies.
Oh, yeah, the gypsies. There's some...
Children of the Night. What music they make. I'm going to talk about that line in my subscriber-only movie reviews, listeners. So keep that in mind. Subscribe so you can hear it. Patreon.com/heavyboard. But we're getting there anyway, but I was going to ask, like, as we move towards the end, what do we think of the ending? What do we think, like, as we got there?
I did not love the ending. I felt disappointed by the ending. It felt very, like, I can see how there's like one exciting scene and there, like, I can see how maybe visually it would be more exciting, but there is no final encounter. Like, there's no real, like, what's the other than, okay, what happens right before the very end? Like, what's their last real encounter with any vampire? Go on.
It's, so, by the ending is when they're separated into three groups, right? So, Harker Quincy, is it? Or no?
Seward? Is it Seward and Quincy?
Yeah.
And Arthur?
three groups of two. Yeah, and then Mina and Van Helsing have the last encounter with what you would call the female vampires, right? Like,
Van Helsing. Yeah, so that's like the only real vampire encounter we get at the ending, right? They go.
It's like the third to last chapter. Yeah, they're at Dracula's castle, and so they're in the woods, right? Where, like, the woods are mysterious. Not a lot of people venture into them because they're dangerous, right? Everybody that ventures into them locally doesn't come back because it's Dracula's property, and you'll either get bitten, eaten by the wolves or the female vampires, or Dracula himself will, like, kill you, right? So. That's why the woods are dangerous. Van Helsing comes up with this clever idea of grinding, like, the Eucharist, or what they would call, right, the blessed cracker or wafer or bread, right? The kind of body of Christ symbolically. You grind that and then put it into, like, a powder and then, like, put it around you in, like, a circle. They can't cross the threshold, right? So he, like, uses that to avoid getting attacked by the female vampires. But the very end, like that last chapter, is like the gypsies are moving Dracula's coffin up to his castle from the river, right? And it's during the day, so Dracula's kind of helpless, and this is what they all planned for. And then, like, as they're approaching, right?
Like,
yeah, he's in it. It's like the last box.
It's his only coffin.
Yeah, because Van Helsing went to the house during the day and destroyed the women's boxes and put a Eucharist in Dracula's box so that he couldn't go back into the one in the actual castle. But so the only one left is the one that the gypsies are moving up the hill. And that's when they all three kind of finally converge and kind of pounce. And they have to fight with the gypsies who are ordered and paid off, right, to defend this box at all costs. So Quincy Morris gets stabbed as they're trying to get to the box in this, like, you know, rickety kind of mountain wagon pass. And then they eventually rip the lid off of and kill him once they fight their way through the gypsies.
Yeah, they pry it open and, yeah, they just stab him.
And that's that. And I didn't mind the ending. I thought it was a little bit cheap that only Quincy Morris was the one who got stabbed and killed. I thought more people should be injured and or killed when they're trying to do this. But
yeah, I mean, I get it. They did it the smart way. So, like, they just, you know, open his box and kill him. But, like, I feel like there was no excitement in it, really. Like, there's a little bit of that, like, struggle that happens between the two groups. But, yeah, I felt like for so many chapters of No Dracula, there was very little payoff by the end.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't think that's something that would fly. Like, you know, I don't think that's the way you would write it today. I think maybe because the story of Dracula isn't about Dracula, really. It's about, like, this group.
Right. Yeah.
And, like, this mysterious vampire character, right? It's not really, like, about the vampires.
Yeah, I mean, I flew through it. The ending was not the best, but I didn't mind the ending. I thought it was fine, not great. But I'd find, like, most endings in horror.
I was pissed that this was the final battle. I was, I was holding out for it. I was like, oh, my God, we've been on this ship. We've been just, like, in hotels or, like, you know, in a carriage, like, going, you know, just get, like, following Dracula and trying to figure it out. Like, for chapter after chapter.
Well, the ticking clock is...
something happens.
Like, the ticking clock is they have to reach Dracula before he gets to his castle, because otherwise he gets his castle, there's nothing they can do once he's in there and, like, can protect it with the wolves and all this other stuff. Like, it's, that's the ticking clock. That's why they have to, like, all three go and not be able to communicate with each other, just have to trust that they're going to do what they said they would.
I've suspended so much disbelief at this point, though, that it's just like, why not have the harder battle?
What would you
suggest? But I guess, you know, they planned it so carefully, right? Like, you know, I would just, like, I don't know. I wanted to get back to the castle again. I wanted a wolf attack. I wanted more of a struggle. It felt like it was just over so quickly for something that we were waiting so long to happen, right? This confrontation. And it's not really a confrontation. It's more of just, you know, a stabbing.
Stabbing and beheading. Yeah, I mean, I didn't mind it. I liked the novel. I had never read it before, and I'm glad I did, because otherwise I would have just taken everybody else's word for it as to what the story is. And it's one of those stories where you do know a lot of the details because it's just so ingrained in our culture. And there's been so many movies made and all that kind of stuff, right? People dressing up as Dracula for Halloween for the last 120 years, all that kind of stuff. Which I'll get into, again, listeners, in the Patreon only, where I go into some of these movies. In terms of the look of Dracula, how that came about, the directors that kind of created the look that we now associate with it. The visual kind of pop culture elements, but... yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think endings to a lot of horror stories are not great.
Yeah.
But I, like I said, I read it in 4 days, and I kind of really enjoyed it way more than I thought I would enjoy it. Because it was kind of like a pure pulp kind of thriller.
Oh, yeah, I agree with that. It was fun. I did get bored at parts, though. And I did want more payoff at the end. But yeah, that's just me.
You want Dracula to win?
Not necessarily, but I wanted more struggle. I mean, not that, you know, there wasn't any, but I guess that's the other danger, right? Like, we also didn't get the battle from every perspective, right? It's like the last thing that happens. We get the battle from one perspective.
Yeah, well, we get it through Mina, and Mina's watching from up above in her little circle of ground up Eucharist. So it's like she's watching up there, and she sees like the groups of the men like kind of converging from the different directions, which is what they planned on doing, right? They had to kind of approach from different directions, different ways of traveling to ensure that each way was covered the way Dracula would get back to his castle. So yeah, and then she sees the convergence in like that little gorge. She's like above them watching. So you get it all from
that.
Yeah,
so that's all just to say, like, it ends really quickly. We don't hear from the people that are actually doing the killing. We just see Mina seeing everything.
Well, the people actually doing the killing, we don't really get their diaries or journals or anything the entire time.
Right,
we
that's
just
what
get,
I'm
like,
saying.
Yeah. Could have killed more characters.
It is over really quickly. Like, we don't get that backtracking. We don't get any, like, filling in.
I think Van Helsing maybe could have been killed if we wanted to do that.
Or at the very least, gravely injured. Something's got to happen. Someone's got to, like, lose a hand or something. But, yeah. I mean, again, ending I thought was a little boring, but it was the right mood, the right tone, you know, for an October read while you're waiting for all of those shitty Netflix movies to come out, become available. Yeah, did you have anything else?
No, that was it.
Yeah.
But buy yourself a copy. It's linked in the description. Read it,
yeah,
so that you don't just take people's word for it. Read it and say what you think, not just... So we've done a couple books like this so far where there's just like, there's the legend around it, there's the popularity around it, and then there's the actual book itself. This is one, yeah, where I wasn't disappointed by it, but
yeah,
I was surprised, actually.
Pretty quickly, you know, for a 300-page book, it reads pretty quickly, and there were parts that, like, I got a little hung up on just because, like, when... there are characters that are maybe written in a dialect that can be hard to understand.
The
right,
Dutch.
So there were certain phrases. Yeah, I mean, like, there were just certain phrasings I didn't fully grab onto. But those parts were pretty minimal. It was usually, like, getting a story from an outsider who had, like, a heavy...
Dutch accent.
I wouldn't even say it was about, like, whether it was Dutch or anything, right? Like, Van Helsing has an accent, too, so we don't have...
Well, he's the one that's Dutch, yeah.
Yeah, like, I mean, there are just words missing, right, for his. But his is fairly easy to read. I would say, I mean, there's still some, like, you know, if you struggle at all, you might have some struggle there, but... yeah, no, like with the zookeeper guy or the guy that they're interviewing for the zoo, that kind of guy who's like talking in a lot of slang. Right?
Yeah. The Hackney British. Hey, I got no over there.
Yeah. Yeah, that's when it gets fucking hard.
Yeah, like the
I'm
kind
just like,
of
what
like.
What the fuck is this word? Yeah. Like, even if I like do it in my head or try to do it out loud, I'm like, yeah, I can't figure this shit out. But again,
and if you think
really
this is where the realism. Trend was happening too, right? In literary circles, you were seeing a lot of the accents, the slang, the way different characters from different parts of not just the world, but different parts of the city, right? Or different parts of the rural urban landscape, how they spoke. and like writers at this time were starting to become more obsessed with capturing that, like different vernaculars, different ways of speaking, the kind of omissions of certain sounds. And then like, yeah, when he's talking with some of the locals in London and around England, right? Like they have the kind of like not prim and proper speech, like all the doctors and everybody else was speaking, and like lawyers and stuff, and like the prim and proper women like Mina and Lucy, how they were speaking. It was like, you know, like we don't stay in castles. like this is how we talk. And that's this was just the time where that was happening. But yeah, I will say some of my German did help me read some of the fucking Dutch that Van Helsing breaks into here and there, but obviously they're different, but they are pretty closely related.
Yeah. That shit didn't help me at all.
I know very little German, listeners, but the little bit that I did help me kind of be, oh, he's saying my God there, like mein Gott.
Yeah.
It's just like, yeah.
Well, that's when if you hear it out loud, you don't question what it is, right? It's just like, it sounds close enough. That's the great thing about German. It's pretty close to English.
Structurally is really what makes it a little bit easier.
Well, it's like basically, you know, it's the parent of English, essentially.
Yeah, like and the parent of Dutch, the parent of, the northern parts of Europe there. It was like, yeah, the only reason I find German easier is because structurally it's the same as English.
Right.
So every other language I learn, it's backwards. And like compared to like the English.
Beer. And water is Wasser.
Wasser, yeah. Bier und Wein, Wasser.
Oh yeah, all the W's are V's.
Wasser,
I forget that sometimes.
Yeah.
But
just because like it's not backwards, you don't have to say like the brother of Maria. You just say Maria's brother, you would in English. Yeah. So it's like different than like the other languages that I'm half-ass learning, but yeah. Helped a little bit. But yeah, that's it. That's all I got, dude.
Yeah, it's good shit. Good for a Halloween read.
Yeah, let us know what you
check
think,
it out.
Listeners.
I probably will not do what Andy did and watch the, you know, silent film, because that just sounds like a terrible time to me. It just sounds like a really garbage evening.
Yeah, as I mentioned, listeners.
But if silent film compels you, please, by all means.
As I mentioned.
You've only watched the movies up through the 70s, and that all sounds terrible to me.
I don't know why I decided to do this, but I decided to do this. And yeah, Sophie wasn't game for it. So I was just like,
there's so fucking many of them.
Fuck it. I'll just.
I'm like game for it, but I'm not going to watch all of those.
So I'm just going to do this. I don't know why I wanted to do this, but I basically gave myself this project. I'm watching 9 Dracula movies. I've watched the first 4. I'm going to watch the 5th one tonight. And I'm probably going to release this maybe a week after we release this episode. For like a Halloween thing, there's so many Dracula movies. I've narrowed it down to just the 9 that specifically try to make the novel into a movie. So I'm doing just specifically the novel adaptations. So we have, you know, 120 years of movies, basically 100 years of movies that have been making this novel. So I'm going to go into all 9 of those and, do a little.
Are there any really recent ones?
The most recent one that actually follows the novel or tries to is Coppola's 1992 Bram Stoker's Dracula.
Yeah, okay.
Which I'm watching last. I'm watching them all in order. Yeah, so I'm like halfway, and I'm writing up my monologues on it, and then I'll have that out probably a week after this for only subscribers. So if you want to hear that, subscribe at patreon.com/heavyboard. But yeah, a little treat for listeners. I'll get that done at some point and put that out. But if you're interested in that type of shit. But that's it. Anything else on this? All right. Reminder to listeners, we're still looking for workshop horror stories. If you have a story about a horrific workshop experience, send that to us at heavyboardpodcast@gmail.com. We also have subscription plans. For just a few dollars a month, you can receive full access to our entire catalog, bonus episodes, interviews, all the things we want to get going on the podcast here. For subscribers only, subscribe to that at patreon.com/heavyboard. If you don't want to do that, you can't afford it, there are other ways to support us. You can subscribe on your favorite podcast platform, leave us a 5-star review on Apple or any of the other podcast platforms, and you can subscribe to our YouTube channels, like, share, tell your friends and family about it, write into us at heavyboardpodcast@gmail.com. All those things help support the podcast, so that would help us out. And next week we are doing, where's my list? Carl Phillips, The Coin of the Realm. We're going to discuss a few of the essays in that collection of craft essays on poetry. So get yourself a copy. We'll go into that. And this has been Heavy Board. See ya.
See ya.
Heavy.
Bored.
Heavy.
I am heavy, heavy, heavy
bored.
I may say male is entirely hostile.
No!
Dinner.
Resources.
Life. Friends. Is boring. We must not say so.
Sweats and the day sweats, pal? Pal, I do.